In the beginning, there was a free press. Well, not really, but it sounded good. By the end of the millennium, five men controlled the world's media, and they all preferred plastic to paper. Yet there was one man who operated outside their control. He and his motley crew were known as the People's Democratic Republic of Television. Their mission? To bring the people the awful truth. Tonight, from somewhere inside the PDR TV, please welcome Michael Moore!
Thank you! Thank you! Thank you! Thank you! Thank you! Thank you very much! Thank you! All right, come on. I've got too much awful truth to give you tonight, all right? There's 43 million people in this country who have absolutely no health insurance. I mean, zip, right? I'm sure many of you in here, let's just show of hands. How many people in here do not have health insurance? Look at this, can we get a shot? Hold, keep your hands up. Just get it, especially for our British viewers. This is not the science fiction portion of the show. ma'am, stand up here. Now, you don't have health insurance, right? What are you gonna do if you get sick? I mean, what do you do if you get sick?
Well, I try really hard not to get sick, and then I'm asthmatic, and so you end up experimenting with herbs and using friends' medications.
Herbs? See, that's what we're reduced to.
Desperation will bring about, and for me,
nuts and berries and herbs. We're back in the Stone Ages here. We're just like, we're on the ground looking for something to heal us.
It's true.
There's something wrong with that. This is crazy, isn't it, huh?
Well, I got an idea on how to solve this problem, and, well, I got it from the man himself. Watch this.
Today we are ending welfare as we know it.
It was an historic day back in 1996. President Bill Clinton and the Republicans removed the safety net for lazy, poor people and replaced welfare with workfare. Finally, tens of thousands of single mothers are off the dole, cleaning our toilets and picking up our garbage as they should be. Meanwhile, some got to pay to put their kids in daycare, where they belong. And poor people who hope to get off welfare by going to college have had to drop out and are now scraping roadkill off our streets. So I was thinking, since work solved America's welfare problem, maybe it can solve the healthcare problem too. 43 million Americans don't have health insurance. I heard about a new program at Franklin Memorial Hospital in Farmington, Maine. Some people called it work care. Under work care, people who can't pay their bills are forced to work at jobs around the hospital to pay them off. This work care idea seems to be spreading. When I heard that Jamaica Hospital in Queens was trying to start their own work care program, I went there to check it out. I met with Bruce Flams, the hospital's executive vice president, who explained why making people work off their hospital bill was a good idea.
Here, people would be getting healthcare service in exchange for work.
People are willing to work a second job.
People regularly work second jobs now to make ends meet, and to work an extra hour a day beyond that for health care is something they'd be more than happy to do.
Even if they were working a second job, they'd be willing to work the extra hour. How about a third job?
We had two elderly women who received Medicare, and they said even though they have health insurance benefits through Medicare, could they work so that those credits would go for their kids to get health insurance?
It's a testimony to hardworking American people that you're willing to do this sort of thing.
Yeah, we think so.
The more I talked to Bruce, the more he made sense.
If you haven't paid for your meal, then okay, go clean the dishes.
Right, same thing here. Basically, if you can't pay for the appendicitis, you know, go peel some potatoes.
Work care was just sounding better and better.
Now, you don't have this program set up yet, right?
We're in the process of trying to set it up.
It's not set up right now today.
It's not set up today. We're hoping with the opportunity to maybe get someone with national recognition to launch this program, we'll be able to get the laws passed through Congress that would enable us to enact this program very soon.
I think you found your guy.
Okay.
Right here.
Attention, attention. Are you in need of medical attention? If so, please step up to the table. We can help you. We have a plan.
Yes, I decided to use my celebrity status to get this work care thing off the ground. That day, I hired a real doctor, Sharon Levy, MD. Recruited real registered nurses. Rented an inventory of hospital instruments. and a fully equipped ambulance. I set up a MASH tent across the street from Jamaica Hospital. Then I found real people who were in need of medical care.
If you're willing to work, you know, we'll help you do, get a checkup on the pins and the plate in your leg. She just needs a checkup for her asthma. What would that run? If you're still breathing, you can work.
That's good.
Right?
I have a little hemorrhoid problem that needs to be taken care of.
Really? If you work for us for 8 hours peeling potatoes at $5.25 an hour, so you're going to have to work 20 nights peeling potatoes.
I'm ready to work all night.
Yeah, but you know what? There's 30 nights in a month. You're only going to work 20 nights here. You got 10 nights off, and you'll be able to breathe, okay? Let me know if you run out of the oxygen, and we'll just put it on your bill. You didn't have anything else for her to do?
I can find something for
What can a dizzy person do?
But I don't know anything about engines.
You don't?
No.
Well, ma'am, if you don't learn how to do this, we're not going to be able to help you out.
Well, I can learn, but...
Okay, that's the attitude. That's what we like to hear. Thank you. All right, just take this and fill her up. You got laryngitis? And what else is wrong with you? You're 7 months pregnant.
Here. Is any of this hurt you?
She has an upper respiratory infection.
Oh, wait a minute. Excuse me. Have you finished the ironing yet?
Too bad we can't get the fetus to do something.
Because basically, you got a freeloader inside of her there. You know? I mean, I just don't feel good about, you know, giving her the blood pressure test first before she's done some work, you know, because it's, you know, then they start to think, you know, they can get away doing this for free or something.
Right, like, coming in and taking,
you know, taking advantage of us, hard-earned tax dollars that we're putting into this. You know, we're taxpayers, we pay for this, you know?
Well, maybe she could do a little sewing if she feels up to it.
Sewing, can you do some sewing?
Sure.
I want to be able to see myself in it. If you do a good job here, we'll be able to take another pin out of your leg. When you autograph each one of them, make sure you put something like, you're special to me.
Malik, did you fall and cut yourself?
Want to do some work for us? You want to? Yeah? Okay, come on in here. Come on. You missed the spot.
I was proud of my little operation. It was time to go back to the hospital and bring out the man who wants to bring work care to New York City and maybe pick up a few more non-working sick people.
Ma'am, why are you in here?
Well, I have bronchial asthma and I hurt my hip.
Bronchial asthma and you hurt your hip?
I'm also HIV positive.
And she expected us taxpayers to pay for this? I had to show Bruce how my work care really works.
Real doctors?
Yes, real
doctors. Okay. Hi, Bruce Flans, how you doing? So what do you think? What's your impression of this?
Yeah, well, it simulates a real...
We can't do anything too sterile out here, obviously.
Right, you know?
Suddenly, my conscience began to bother me. It does that from time to time.
Don't we have an ethic in our society that says if you work, you get cash, you get payment for that? You know what I'm saying? It's not, you know.
But it wasn't always that way. If you look back 200 years, people had a
barter. 200 years ago, they had wooden teeth, and
they had a barter system where people
slaves.
Would. Give me just 1 second. I have to talk to one of the guys at work. Okay. Give me 1 second.
Okay. All right.
All of a sudden, a lot of suits showed up, and things got a little complicated.
Well, we didn't know we were doing the MASH tank yet. Who put this up?
What's the problem?
Huh?
What's the problem?
We're not in some play-acting role here, okay? I don't understand what your setup
that's
is.
That's a real doctor. Those are real nurses.
This
These
is,
are real people that
this
need
is,
help.
This is
and
nothing.
We're having them work
excuse
for
me,
us so
me.
They can get their health care. Isn't that
you
what
can,
you believe
you
in?
You can do whatever you'd like here.
Health care for work, right?
Make people work, too, before you fix them. That's another thing, too, you know?
Because
they don't know when they're going to get sick, so they should get fixed. They should get work for us first before we help them out.
This is ridiculous. Come on.
I just think that you're just jealous because you don't have your program going yet, and we got ours already going. You're just envious of it.
Go ahead and do your program.
Why don't you join in with our program?
Go ahead and do your program.
What kind of health insurance do you have?
Go ahead and do your program.
Are you covered, sir?
I'm not answering your question.
Do you have any medical problems that I can help you with
in
here?
Thank you very much.
You know? All right, I'm sorry. This he was hostile. I'm really sorry, you know? If you need any help, come on back.
These guys obviously weren't serious about work here. So I decided to take my program nationwide and travel from state to state to pick up sick people and put them to work for me.
Very much. Let me ask you this. Who started the whole Monica Gate impeachment mess? Where did it really begin? Linda Tripp? No. Lucianne Goldberg. That's right. She was the person who convinced Linda Tripp to tape record all of her phone calls with Monica Lewinsky. All right? This is a Lucianne Goldberg here. You remember her? Huh?
There she is.
Right. Let me just show you just a brief soundbite from her regarding how proud she is of having Linda Tripp wire herself on Monica Lewinsky.
I went, yikes, is this fun? Wow, is this an intern? You know, I'm not going to say I got all, you know, moralistic about it. No, I thought it was a ball to listen to this stuff.
This is not how we are as Americans, right? We should tell our British audience that we respect each other's privacy. In fact, we thought it was so important, we put it into our Constitution. It's our Fourth Amendment, right? We should not invade another one's right to privacy, right? I was on a show with her recently on this Matt Drudge show, and I'm in the makeup room with her, and she tells me that it was her client, Mark Furman, who told her, she's Mark Furman's book agent, right? There's a dream team for you.
You remember Mark Furman from the OJ case?
He's the LA police detective who has a particular love for a certain word that begins with N. It was Furman's idea to take a wet Q-tip and get the DNA off the dress. So Goldberg told Tripp to get into Monica's closet with the Q-tip and get it off the dress. I'm sitting there, you know, in the makeup room thinking about this, and I thought, I wonder how Lucianne Goldberg would like it if I stole some of her DNA. So just watch what happened.
Did you get made up in here?
Yeah, I'm finished.
You're all set with you? You're done your
makeup? Me in the chair.
She gave me bangs that I didn't have when I came in.
That's her cup.
Okay,
right
so
here.
I thought, okay, this is what I'm going to do. I grabbed her coffee cup with the lipstick on it, put it in the bag. Then I went and got to her makeup stuff. That was the piece of the sponge that was used on her, right there. I got the plastic gloves on, so everything's clean. Then I start taking her hairs out of the brush. And then when that wasn't good enough, I decided to take some hairs. Now watch this. Here we go. Watch this. I pulled the hair right out. Now this is for the good of the country. I asked her to kiss me, so
I told me Mark Furman told me to do this. You got it?
Right in the bag. She had no idea I was doing this, all right? So I had saliva samples, I had hair. But then this guy tells me, just before I go out on the stage, that a hair or saliva sample test for DNA costs like $15,000. And you can tell by the look of the show that we... So I'm sitting there, geez, I'm like, oh, what can I do? What can I do to teach her a lesson about how important our right to privacy is? And then it sort of came to me, when I went out on the show with her. And let's just roll that clip.
How about if I was, like, you know, filming what was going on in your apartment?
If I
was... took your right to privacy
away. Well, Linda filmed no one's apartment. Uh-huh. But if I was threatening you...
Yeah.
And telling you what the President of the United States right. wanted you to lie under
right,
oath,
right.
and you taped me,
right.
I would deserve that.
Well, she was threatening me. In fact, she was threatening all of us as citizens in a democratic republic. And it was at that moment that I decided that that's what I would do. Our long national nightmare with Monica Gate may be over, but Lucianne's nightmare is about to begin tonight. And welcome to I See Lucy. What I have done is I have a web camera placed directly across the street from the apartment of Lucianne Goldberg. This is one of these new internet cameras. And if we can go to the live shot of that right now in New York City, there, that is the apartment, ladies and gentlemen, of Lucianne Goldberg. That's her living room on the left. That's her bedroom on the right. And this camera is now set up, and it's going to be on the internet live 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Beginning tonight, Lucianne Goldberg loses her right to privacy. Go on the internet to www.iclucy.com and you can keep an eye on what she is up to, all right? We'll be back again next week with I See Lucy. Here's what I want to know. Who put the word mental in fundamentalist? All right? I respect all religions, but I don't understand fundamentalists, all right? I wish they would focus more on the fun in fundamentalists than the mental part. But unfortunately, that's not the way it turns out to be. And in Afghanistan right now, a particular group of fundamentalists have taken over. They're called the Taliban. And they do a lot of, you know, bad things. Women can't go to school. They can't show their faces in public. They torture them. They've banned a lot of things. But they've done something that personally offends me. And it has to do with my TV. Please watch.
100 years ago, the mighty British Empire tried to take over a little country called Afghanistan. But the Afghanis whipped some British butt. Then things went back to normal. In 1979, the Soviet Union invaded, and the Afghanis whipped some Soviet butt. Thanks to U.S. meddling, there was a long civil war. A religious army called the Taliban finally took control of Afghanistan. It seemed like maybe peace would finally come to a war-torn land. But then the Taliban started banning things. At first, it was just Jerry Falwell type stuff. No movies, no drinking, no music.
At weddings, we had music and singing, and they made us stop.
But then things got really weird. Edicts were issued. No kite flying, no paper bags, no pet parakeets, no pet parakeets. And then the final straw, no more television. That's right, no more TV. They blew up satellite dishes, ripped up videotapes, and they smashed TV sets. Now, I've never been much of a drinker, and frankly, parakeets are kind of filthy and annoying. But I really love watching TV. So I paid a little visit to the Taliban. The United Nations won't let them in, but they do have an office out in Queens, conveniently located between a liposuction clinic and a fast food joint.
I'm Michael Moore, yeah. And you are?
How are you? Abdul Hakim Mujahid.
I just wanted to go over the various restrictions that the Taliban government has imposed. The government has said that you can't have a trimmed beard like an American beard, that you have to let the hair grow. Can you explain that?
All of the prophets, the messengers who came to this world, they had their beards.
Many people in this country who were prophets or visionaries had beards. I understand the government issued an order that said you've got 15 days to turn your TV sets in.
It is totally wrong, and this is a kind
not
of
true.
Negative propaganda.
Wait, I saw this, where people had to turn their TVs off, stop watching TV, bring and turn in their TVs, get rid of their TVs. I saw this.
Yes or no? Did you confiscate those TVs?
Yes.
Do you watch TV when you're here in America? Do you ever watch TV?
Why not?
Why not, yeah. Oprah or Springer?
I didn't say only news.
That would be Springer. As Americans, you know, television is a basic right. It is like, it's like food, shelter, clothing, Baywatch. You know what I'm saying?
No.
On our show, I want to appeal to people to send food, clothing, money, and TVs to Afghanistan.
I took his enthusiastic response as a yes and went about trying to find a national spokesperson for my Afghan TV relief project. Actually, I knew who I had to get.
Hi, I'm Sally Struthers. Won't you please help? That old television in your basement would mean so much to these people. The cost to you is only pennies a day, but just one set can bring TV to a whole tent full of Afghanis. Approximately once a month, you'll receive a photograph or short videotape of your TV with its new family. Just watch their faces light up when they stumble across a rerun of Dharma and Greg. Act now, before another Afghan child misses out on a life full of television. It takes so little from you and makes such a big difference for them. Won't you please help?
Inspired, I took to the streets to collect the TVs for Afghanistan. I had to get on the case myself.
Hello world, in the song that we're singing. Come on, get happy.
I was proud of the way America responded.
This is what we'll be bringing. We'll make you happy.
First stop, the Taliban office.
Mr. Ambassador, we would like to give you a gift.
How could they say no to a van load of free TVs?
We'd like to present this to you. Give it to him? Okay, sorry, give it to you.
The ambassador wouldn't even touch it.
We'd like to present this gift to you, okay? It's a television. It's got a remote control here.
His aide seemed a little more interested when we told him Dateline had added a fifth night, but I knew these TVs would never make it to the Afghanis. It was time to airdrop TVs on Afghanistan. Okay, so that's our show tonight, and be sure and tune in next week where we'll check out what Lucianne is doing and a bunch of other people right here on The Awful Truth. Thank you very much. Good night.